Let me just share.
That'll be good.
let me just share our intro slides here. So thank you to everyone for being here. Thank you. You're joining us for Live with Julie Pennal and Nicole Wedgerfield. We always try to start our sessions with a little bit of preparing for participation. Oftentimes we try to do an Indigenous acknowledgement as well. I think because we are focusing on wood today and craftsmanship, it would be important for us to take a moment and maybe prepare our participation with an Indigenous acknowledgement. So as folks who are participating likely know, Oakville is traditionally land which is a treaty land, and essentially Oakville is relatively young in terms of the life of our land, and in sort of recognizing that, we want to thank those who were here before us for stewarding the land and allowing us to have access to the wonderful resources which we have today, particularly in the form of wood and our natural resources, which we can turn into things that are beautiful. So certainly thank you, and just sort of acknowledging our Indigenous folks and neighbors who have been here so long on this land and being great stewards of it for us to enjoy. As far as instructions go for participation, please feel free to use the chat box. I will say that traditionally for our live sessions with Julie and Nicole, everyone's free to talk and take their microphone off. So while you can use the chat box function, if you're feeling shy, feel free to just take your microphone off and communicate directly with Don, Julie, or myself. Of course, simply ensure that we are respecting one another and each other's perspectives. I don't imagine our talks to become very contentious, but in the event that there are opinions or whatever that you hear that you don't align with, just ensuring that we are being respectful. That is it for the housekeeping on my end. And I'm really excited because I'm from what Julie's told me, we have a special guest today. So thank you all for joining. And Julie, I'll turn it over to you to introduce our guest.
Awesome. Thanks, Daniel. So you're here today with Don Hillam, who began carving while in high school in 1983. So he's just a baby. He has participated in competitions since 1985, earning several prestigious awards. His specialties are songbirds, hawks, owls, and wildfowl. He prides himself on the finer details of his birds, striving to bring each bird's personality out in the wood. Don is continually building upon his knowledge and honing his skills to attain greater accuracy and detail in his carvings, consulting with other experts and studying birds in their natural settings. Don promotes his art at various venues, does commission work, and takes on students. He is actually one of our instructors here at the Colburn Center. So we've had the pleasure of getting to know him over the past few years when he took over from a former teacher. And Don has a loyal following, and I have been very blessed to be the recipient of one of his pieces. I have a lovely little, he calls it a worry bird, and it sits on my coffee table, actually. And whenever I'm bored, which right now is all the time, I'm wearing him down, Don. I worry him with my thumb. So I'm going to turn it, maybe. I'm turning it over to you, Don, to do some chatting and sharing. And anybody has any questions, feel free to pop in at any time. Okay. So take it away, Don.
Thank you for the introduction and thank you for joining us. I started in high school. I was lucky. I had a teacher who was a world-renowned woodcarver, and I took classes after school, and he basically took me under his wing and taught me more and more about carving. But after high school, I basically went on my own and started pursuing it. And as you're young, you let it go for a little bit, but as you get older, you get back into it. And I had a great opportunity to come to the center, and Julie hired me on, and it's been nothing but sheer awesomeness. I love the people there, Julie, Nicole, everybody there, just excellent, excellent staff. And I wouldn't want it any other way. So thank you again. When we carve, we start off with basically a block of wood, like so. I'm gonna have to turn around and show you every time I have to show you a piece. This is a cardinal, a male cardinal, and it's made out of basswood. Basswood is basically a very standard wood that we use in the industry. You can use basswood, tupelo. Tupelo comes from actually Louisiana swamps. It's very light, but very expensive. So this is basically a better wood, I find, a little bit more stable. And people seem to, they like it better, I find. when I'm carving and I'm starting a bird, and this is how we start, is we have a blank like this, and we have a booklet like this. So you have information in a booklet, you have photographs, a bird, the bird we're studying, you have a pattern. I don't know, can you see all that? Yeah. So there's a pattern of a cardinal, and it has measurements right here. These measurements help us make the detail and the points that we need to cut in, groups, bills, eyes, etc. So if I'm gonna start a bird like this, I need to know some basic facts of carving. You need a pencil, you need a knife, and you need, if everybody worries at the center, this, the knife. It's a very, very sharp knife. You cannot carve my class unless you know how to use a knife. That is absolutely priority number one, no matter where I carve or where I teach. This is very important because these are sharper than a scalpel. Okay. So with this, we'll teach you how to sharpen a knife. This is called a strop. Very, very inexpensive. And we have basically all the stuff on hand you can use. I always start with a knife first. I never start with a grinder because it's easier, more simpler. You have more control with this too. And the more you can use this, the faster you get the wood off. And for me, getting the wood off fast is the most important thing I can do. So I will demonstrate a little bit on that. So this cardinal, when you do a basic carving, you have to have guidelines. So on a bird, we want to draw lines straight up the back. I'm just going to do this very fast. Straight down the side. I'll show you after I do it. Straight down the side like this. All these lines do is give us a balancing point of carving. Because whatever you do on one side, you must do on the other. Otherwise, the bird could look like this when you're done. You want everything to be balanced. Because birds are very balanced like people. We don't, you know, we don't walk like this. We walk very straight. So I'm just going to put the lines on here I need. This bird here has a turned head. So there's an axis on a bird's head. So from the tip of the bill, I'm just going to draw this out real quick. So I can curve it out fast. There we go. All these lines I'm doing, the one thing that I find most satisfying for everybody is that if I carve a bird, whatever bird that I carve, you carve, I carve the same bird. So if we're doing a cardinal, I carve it with you. So if you're going to learn how to use a knife and how to carve properly, I want you to see what I'm doing. And I also want you to have a visual. So that helps people that are more visual, and it stimulates so you can actually look at it and you can pick it up. And it really, really helps. So if I'm getting a little further than you are, you can always go back and look at this bird, because I always carve 1, 2, 3, 4 birds. So in here, I have all these birds in my hand. So this is my first start. I'm just going to show you quickly. This would be when I cut a little bit of wood off. This is going to be more advanced. As the bird, the head and the body all start to come together. This is a lot more advanced. And this is all done with knife. This is not done with knives and chisels. It's not done with grinders. We can use electrical tools. It's a lot easier to do with knife at first, but you can advance into that. So I'm just gonna cut a little bit just to show you how fast you can actually take wood off a bird. This knife, you must learn how to use it properly. Like again, I can't share that enough. This is really, really sharp. So the knife is only as good as the person's gonna use it, and there's no foolery with this thing when it's in hand, okay? So if I'm cutting this bird, I'm just gonna prop myself up a little bit. I'm just gonna round this bird from a square. I don't want any squareness in this bird. I want it to be round because a bird's not square, obviously. All these hard edges gotta come off. But there are little things we must do. I don't know if I can show you this because it's kind of blurrier. I've halved all the lines, half down the back, half on the bottom, and half on the side. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a few more lines. I'm going to half those halves again. Kind of funny the way I say. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to knock off these. Oops. I'm going to knock off this little quarter, this little edge right here. And that's going to take that from being really hard and sore in my hand. That is hard. That hurts to hold that for a while. So I'm going to take all those chunks off so it's nice and easy to hold. Okay. So I'm going to do this. As I do this, I'm going to stand up a little bit. Hopefully you can see. See here. My hand, I can't actually hurt myself this way. I can only pull myself in. So I'm actually only using my wrist to carve, to pull the knife towards me, to get that little bit of piece of wood off. And this is called a power stroke because I've got a lot of power in my hands. And my computer is eating the rest of the wood. Now, that's a pull stroke towards yourself. If you're gonna go away from yourself, you literally, I'm gonna show you my hands only. I use my thumb on my thumb. This is very important to learn this technique. So you cannot cut yourself by doing these techniques. I've only cut myself 4 times, and that's 30 some odd years I've been carving. So control of a knife is really important.
Those are pretty good odds, Don.
And I think one of them was, yeah.
Don't tell it. Now I know why there's so many shavings on the floor in room A and B after your class, after seeing that power move, right, Nicole? There's wood chips flying everywhere. Love it.
We leave a trail. So if we know that somebody sneaks out of the class, I know where you are. So just let everybody know, I know where you go. you get used to it and you get very comfortable, but it takes a little while to get the strength in your hands to do that. And also this wood is very dry. Like I've had it for a long time. So this wood actually comes from Petawawa area, which is really nice area. I love that area. The drier the wood, the easier it is. It can be very heavy and can be very hard because this is actually a hardwood, but it's actually very soft. And it can be both, but it's a very strong wood, very sturdy wood anyways. So I wanted to show you a few ways to carve feathers. And I think that would be a lot more fun to see than me just carving a block. So if I take a feather, can you see this really well in there? This is a drawn feather. And on the back and on the front, this is actually a scrap piece of wood. So what's happening is before I carve, and I'm not sure how to carve a feather, or I want to explore how to do a split on a feather, I'll take a scrap piece of wood and I'll play with it. This is where you're really growing. You have a lot of fun. Now, one thing I can say, honestly, our class is about having fun. It's not about you being better than me being better, because nobody's better than anybody else. We have fun. You know, we generally have smear marks on the windows as people walk by in the center, right? I'm sure there's a lot of glass cleaning going on because we laugh pretty loud at that glass. Yeah, exactly. A lot of this. I'm just going to demonstrate a quick few burnings. I hope you can see the detail. If you can't see it, I'll show you. Just this is actually a feather. This would be like a feather on a duck, like on the chest of a duck or on the back of a bird. So kind of bird, let me see, would be right here on this is the cardinal's back on this area here, or would be up in here in the top of the breast area. Excuse me just for a second, I'm just going to turn my burner on. This piece of equipment right here is called a coal wood burner. This thing heats up very, very hot. So it's very, it can burn anything. You can burn leather. You can burn basically wood, anything you want with it. Gourds even. It's a pretty cool little tool. They're about $100, but I'll tell you, they sure are worth their weight in gold. Change my bit. This one here, you can change the bit. You can either change the whole handle or you can change the bit out. Now this one, not too warm. And you don't use it for doing tattoos. That's one thing you don't do. Now, John, I could see trying that, putting mother on his arm. So this is what they call a Bob Googie pen. The pen is actually, can you see that? Yeah, it's bent. So what happens is on the bending, the bending is there for the reason so I can lay it actually flat and create a line. So what happens is when you're doing a barb on a feather, the feather is actually flatter than the barb. The barb sits higher than the feather. So if you look at an eagle feather, a big long feather, the stem or the barb itself sits just a touch higher. So with this, what we're going to do is we're going to compress the wood and we're going to create two lines that are eventually going to make a barb. So I don't know, see if you can see me doing this, but if you can't, I will show you as soon as I'm done here. So all I'm doing is taking this and I'm pushing it in the wood and I'm slowly drawing with it. That's the cool thing about this. You can do anything. You can do pyrography, you can do a picture, you can do a photo, you can burn high, low, light, soft, create valleys, just great stuff. This is a really great tool to play with. And if you got time to do a lot of, get into something, get so focused, this will drop 16 hours of your day. You should get one, Julie. This would really keep you busy. And another worry bird, just let you know.
Yes, I have nothing else to do, Don. That's what I'm going to do now. I'll run out and get it. Thank you.
That's what Nicole said. You had nothing to do. Right, Nicole?
Now.
She's so quiet down there. So what I'm doing is I'm actually thinning out the feather. I don't know if you can see that. It's thick up here because this would be the top of the shaft that pins into the bird, into the wing. And this thinness, it allow at the tip, obviously, it thins out because it goes from thick to thin. But if you could see that is actually higher than that wood now because I've compressed all this. And this tool, that's what that does. Or you can burn edges on the feathers like this, or I can burn here. I'm going to put a split in.
Don, is it just making a mark of a burn or is it actually scarring into like depth of the wood?
Yeah, you can see it there. It's actually burning into the wood. It's scoring the wood.
It is scoring the wood. Yeah.
Yeah. It's heating and compressing the wood. So it will do a really sharp edge, or you can use rounder bits to do that as well. And it just compresses the wood. So this will take a wood and flatten, right? And it'll heat it up. And it just gives an excellent crispy edge. That's just one tool that we can play with. But I'm going to throw another tool on here just to show you how to make a feather. Feather lines, that is. This tool, which I can buy many, I can buy a lot of different tips. If I was into pyrography, I would say I did a drawing of a cat or a dog. I can buy round tips, square tips, elongated tips like this, 45 tips, which this is, which come in about five different sizes. This is a very long skew. So, and you can see the pen, it heats up with a cord. That's the pen itself. It has a piece of cork here, so it gets comfortable. Sometimes I would be 16 to 24 hours carving up, just texturing with this alone. I actually used to take elastic bands and wrap it around my hand, and I'd wake up at nighttime like this asleep.
What is pyrography?
Well, pyrography is, it's taking a photo and putting it on a piece of wood and burning all the highs and lows. Like you would do shadowing and you would burn it dark. And then if you were doing a light edge, just to show, you know, just the light edge of the person's face here. And then you would shadow it with all these different types of depths of burning, dark, light, medium, right? You create shadows. It's really, really awesome stuff. But for carving, we do a little bit of that. We don't do a whole lot, obviously, because we're burning feathers. I'm going to show you how to make a feather now. If I'm using a burner, I can use it quite a different amount of ways. I can burn from the barb back to the tip of the feather, or I can burn from the tip of the feather back in. There's a reason why we do that. We burn from the tip of the feather back into the barb. It's because I want the feather to stand out on the bird. If I want it to lay soft, I burn from the barb back. So I'm just going to find out how hot this is. Okay. So for every width of a nickel, you can have 50 to 75 barbs. So you can imagine if you're doing a bald eagle, you can say goodbye to your wife for about 6 months because that's how long it's going to take you to texture a bird that large. It really is long. Like a feather, which is 12 inches, will take you a day, just a day alone to carve. So I'm just going to show you a couple lines. So all I'm going to do is take this. I'll see if I can do it right here. And I'm going to do mine backwards because I want the feather to stand out. Now it's going to be really, really fine. And what I'm doing is I'm actually taking it, I'm laying it down and I'm pulling it up towards the barb, but I'm elongating my feathers because feathers don't go like this. And this is what I wanted to show when you're texturing a bird. Let's see if I can, just going to darken up so it shows better. There is a right way and there is a wrong way to texture. And that's something that takes a little bit of time to get used to. And I just want to let everybody know, there's no wrong way of doing anything on this. It's all experience, it's all fun. So you have to know your wrongs before you know your rights. And I think the greatest thing we can do in this class is to learn a lot of wrongs because that's how you get right on, you know, and there's no mistakes. It's all learning. It's all growth. And I love that part of it because I've seen everybody in my classes go from knowing nothing to basically intermediate international people. I've got a young fellow, my friend's 82 now, he's intermediate level and fantastic. Got more ribbons than I got. That really makes me mad. So I got to teach myself better. I'm just not learning. I'm one of those kids hard to learn.
So Don, so, you're making like the little tiny marks right now. Is that what you're doing?
What I'm doing is I'm making the fine lines that make up the feather. So I'm just letting the bar, I'm letting it sit. Here, let's see if you can see. I'm letting it
That's
sit.
Better. That's actually better.
Pulling it. I'm letting it sit and I'm pulling it. And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to make it consistent. So I don't want it to have a big space. I want them to be absolutely consistent or tight as I can beside each other. So it takes a lot of relaxing and a lot of focus to do this. You really just need to sit down and be really relaxed and alone. Don't let anybody, you know, you can't have people in the room when you're doing this. It really is a thing you do by yourself.
Can you turn it up to the camera, Don? There you go. Oh, there we go. Okay.
I'm just trying to see if I can see it. Can you see that?
Yeah.
All that tightness is all those feathers. Like there's probably about 50, 60 lines in that width there. And that's pretty loose. Generally, I put binoculars on and there you can see. Now you can see a little better. I generally put binoculars on. And I do about 50 to 70 barbs, like per width of a nickel. So it's a lot of work, but I enjoy it. It relaxes me actually. So that's doing a soft feather on a back. So if I was doing, I want to show you a do and a don't at this point. This is a do, the way you should do a feather. But if you're doing a don't, you don't do this. This is how I started out. And
can you lift up your piece of wood a little bit, Don? I know it's hard. There you go.
Yeah.
That's perfect.
It's just hard for me to
I know that. It's hard to carve that way.
Yeah. This is what they call a Christmas tree effect. I'll show you as soon as I'm done here. Just going to put a few barbs on it. That effect, can you see that right there? There you go.
Now we can, yeah.
Okay, so feathers don't look like Christmas trees. They don't go left and right like that. They actually lay down. It may start up here, but the feather, say it starts up here, but the feather tip will end up here. They're quite elongated. So that's a don't situation. But that is a do situation. You see how elongated those are? Mm-hmm. It's really hard to see because they're really, really fine lines. Mm-hmm. That feather there starts way up here, but the tip of it ends way down there. So that's they sweep the feather, the barbs actually sweep quite long. So that's
so is that more of an advanced technique than Don, what you're showing now? This isn't sort of a beginner skill level or?
No, actually it's a beginner skill level. What happens is we, I think it's who really teaches you this is the way I was taught, the first one I showed you. Mm-hmm. I think it's just how, like, if I was doing it on my own, sometimes in books they teach you how to do that Christmas tree effect, and it is wrong. But again, that's where you start out, right? Some people are very, very more comfortable doing it that way. And sometimes your hands don't allow you to elongate it. It's very hard. It's really kind of awkward to do, but once you get used to it, it's very comfortable, right? You know, it's like riding a bike for the first time. You fall off a few times and then you learn. I think it's just who teaches you the technique. That's what I would say.
So you would use these tools once you have your bird shape created?
Yes.
Is that right?
Yeah. Sorry, Julie.
That's okay. No, I'm just trying to make sure everybody understands the process. So you've done your hand carving.
Yeah, I've done my bird. I'm at this point where I've got my head, my bill, and my eyes in. And this process right here is basically roughing out a bird. Now, I'm at the point now where I have to make some decisions. Do splits, how I'm going to lay the feathers in. Once I get the feathers, oh, there you go. Now you can see it. Once I get the feathers started, I will sand the whole bird. Then I will draw in all the small individual feathers. And then I will go back and remember I showed you that Bob Googie does the edging. And then I'll put all my barbs in. And then I'll texture the whole bird. And I'll spend probably about 2-3 days texturing this. That's if I just use this piece here, the Coleman burner. Mm-hmm. That would finish the bird. But at this point, just to show you in the class what we're doing here, this piece of wood here is a base. We're making a base. This one has actually bark on it. So there's a little, this is a tree. Here, I got it. Sorry, it's kind of hard. This is actually a tree right here, and this is the log. So this is the branch that's actually coming off the log right there. I don't know if you can see that or not, but this is the bark on the tree. So my bird, this sitting on the ground, this bird will actually sit. Let's see if I can give her, oh, there you go. Now you can see a good view of it. This bird is actually gonna sit like that on this piece of wood. And this stuff, doing bases and that, this is so easy, so much fun. And that's what when I was teaching everybody in the class, I said to them, here's how I do mine. And then I put a piece of paper over and said, you can't copy that because you have to do your own way because everybody has their own style. So your style, say all of us here, we'd all do something different. Somebody would put leaves in. I would put brass shimmed leaves in here if I wanted to really make it fancy. But it just goes to show you can start off with something thick and you end up with that. And it's just how you see things. And everybody's different. And that's the awesomeness. And I've seen some guys do some pretty amazing things. I just go, wow, I am absolutely, absolutely excited when I see people take that chance and let loose, because this is the part where you can just enjoy. Chisels, knives, grinders. You can take things and hit it and beat it and do rounding edges. Yeah, it's fun. See if you can just give you a little preview. So this would be a broken branch. So, and then the lifting of all the little bark. And then I'm going to paint all this. And it's going to be really cool looking. Yeah, it's lots of fun.
So John, from that very first piece of wood, like when you've just got a square block to a completed image, what would that take you on average to do something like that cardinal?
If I wasn't texturing the bird and I was doing a smoothie, and I'll show you what I'm talking about. This is a finished bird. This is what I call a smoothie. There's no texturing in this bird. And I just want to show you the difference. This bird being smooth would take me 10 hours to carve and paint. Wow, and that's pretty fast.
Beautiful. He's beautiful.
This one, everybody wants my cardinal. You can't have my cardinal. This is my cardinal. This is Don's cardinal. You can have another one, but not this one. This guy talks to me. He's my little buddy.
Your buddy. I like him. He's gorgeous.
Yeah, cardinals are really cool. But I want to show you something neat. When you can have fun, you can have a Mimi. See, this is the Mimi that makes up the half part of this guy. He is 4 inches long. I'm going to take him out of the picture. You can get a good photo. He is 4 inches long, this little guy. You can see all the backing, and he is the same pattern that I used on the big one.
So he's a smooth one as well, Don?
Yeah, he's a smoothie.
He's smooth. Okay.
Yeah. So these would take, this would take me 5 hours. This would take me 10. Yeah, I'm going to show you a big piece. And this is a big piece that we actually did together. This is a Castro. This is a fully detailed bird, right? So I don't have all the detail, a detailed cardinal here, because as fast as I make them, they're pretty well gone. So I don't know if you can see the detail on that bird. It's very hard to see a lot of detail. Let me get a turn up. There's the hawk. So all this is all grinded.
His face is incredible.
Yeah, lots of fun. They got a really mean, a hawk looks at you and goes, "Hey, who are you?" And an owl goes, "Hey, what's going on? I'm from the 70s, man. You know, hey," that's what they're like. They stare at you like, these guys go, "I don't like you." That's what they're like. They just have these attitudes, you know?
Yeah.
This is the kid in the morning with the attitude, and the owl becomes a kid in the afternoon. They're nicer.
They're very imperious looking.
Yeah, yeah. So this is an owl we did. Just to show you, now I think you can see a lot more detail on this piece. I'm going to bring him up really quite close to the camera. This is his face, and there's a lot of detail in this bird. Now he's got no eyes in it. He's blind right now. He's a little holy, but that's a little owl. But anyways, this guy, I didn't have time to put eyes in him just yet. But he's
beautiful.
Yeah, I wish you could see the details. It's quite intricate. So if I did a cardinal, it would take me 40, 50, could take 100 hours, could take 130 hours. Depends what you put it on.
Wow.
If I was putting it on a branch, fine. Now, that owl I just showed you, this is a branch for this owl. This branch took me 3 weeks to make, because one, I have to make a pattern. I have to make it all. So he sits on a branch like that. I'll show you like that.
Oh, wow.
He's a real hoot.
The baby owl.
What's that? Sorry, I didn't hear you, Nicole. What'd you say?
Is he a baby owl?
No,
he's a baby owl.
Old wise owl. He hangs around Dawn. He has to be old. Old wise owl. Conversations with this owl are a good hoot.
Do you have one of your little worry birds there that you could show us?
Yes, I can show you that.
Now, how long would one of your little worry birds take you?
You really want to know? Eight minutes to carve.
Come on.
Nope. The tools I use to carve these birds are very, like, they are very big and they are very nasty. Like the bits are about that. They're a quarter of an inch shank. And the tools I use, and I'll show you the bit I actually use to grind with it. And it's kind of scary. That would scratch your back if you have a bad scratchy back. That's what I call a donkey. That thing really kicks. Like it's very, very, it's got a very hard grind. So if that hits your hands, you don't have much skin left. So I have to wear a leather glove to be safety. And again, like I said, safety is everything in this industry, because some of the tools we use like this can hurt you. So you have to be cautious all the time. And this is Mr. Green Jeans. This one here, this is green. So different colors give you different grades of how deep they are, the points, and they're very abrasive, and they're meant to tear off wood, and that's why I like them. I'm the type of guy, I'm what they call a power carver. So when I sit down to carve, I want to rip the wood off as fast as I can. And the reason why I did those lines at the beginning is to show you to get the wood off. So when you grab a bird, it's very comfortable, right? Mm-hmm. So here's one of my little birds. This guy has a base. So this bird here is aromatic cedar. So you can take this bird and you can rub it in your hands. Now, I have arthritis in my hands very badly. Mm-hmm. So I exercise every day for an hour, hands, legs, feet. And what it does is it allows me to do that. And that will actually help you. It'll actually help your fingers move, because you got to get blood in your circulation. That's why carving's so good for me, because I have to do it every day, because it gets my fingers moving. And that's why these things are so cool. And I really like doing them because they're just fun. And about eight minutes it takes me to grind it out really fast. Now,
and to get it that smooth at the same time, like you, or is 8 minutes to get the shape?
8 minutes is about to get the shape. So say 8 to 11 minutes. And then I sand it really fast with I sand it three different times. So Yeah. That's why I can sell them for what I do. And here is your bird, Julie. This is called
my zebra bird. That's your zebra bird. My favorite.
Yeah. this looks like chocolate. It's a beautiful color. I love the color on it. It's called zebra wood. it's an African wood, and it's a very hard wood. But this wood just smooths up like silk. It's absolutely gorgeous. It's got a great feeling to it, these birds. And all the different woods that I use, they all feel different. Some are smoother, some are a little bit more. They're not as smooth. But they're all the same shape. And again, they all feel different in your hands. Now the base, I don't think you've seen this. This is the base the bird sits on. I designed this with a little, I'll show you. It's got a little arc to it, but in here there's a little dent. Well, that dent, that helps me rub my thumb. That actually helps my thumb because it's perfectly designed for my thumb to rub. And it actually gets my problem is I got arthritis right here, and that helps my thumb right there. So they work really good. I've been really happy with them.
They are one of my favorite. I mean, I love your big pieces, but I love those little guys. They're just so perfect for a little gift, or to sit on a table, or as you say, to play with if you're sitting and watching television at night. Do you have any of your spoons there, Don?
I just wanted to show you one other thing. Oh, these are the absolutely. Feathers. I gave Julia and Nicole, I gave everybody a feather. In my heart, I really appreciate you guys at the center. You ladies are awesome. And I think it is family. And I think the gifts are personal. So it's say thank you. I really do. I appreciate that.
Well, I look at mine every day, Dawn. It hangs on my bulletin board at work. So I see it. Nicole does too. We see them every day.
Yeah. Here we go.
We treasure them, Dawn, as well, because they are
cool.
Beautiful. Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yep. These are just I look at it every day. Yep.
Thanks. I appreciate that. It's very nice of you. Kind. These things I designed, these feathers that I gave you, I actually had pieces left over and I didn't know what to do with them. I had them for years. And I thought, I got to do something. My wife's going, clean the garage, honey, clean the garage. And I'm going, I like it dirty. It makes it look like I'm doing something. I go out and sit out there and just sit and stare at the stars. No. I literally had to clean the garage or I was not going to get in the house. that's why God made house and God made garage. Woman throws man in the garage, man just builds things just to keep busy. That's how it works. So what ended up happening is I ended up making different types of woods. This is purple heart. This is, I'll tell you what it is. I think this is Asian wood, teak wood. And this is a neat looking wood. This is, you can see that? That's actually a wood of...
it looks mottled. Okay, so it looks spotted.
Yeah. It's leopard wood and it comes from Australia. So these woods I get from exotic woods in Burlington. And I just designed a feather and my sister said, hey, try some leather and beads. I will not go to that leather and bead place and never take a visa with you. Just don't take anything. Take a very empty wallet because these little guys are addictive. These natural beads, I tell you, I bought so many of them. Man, I put them in my pocket. I just love these little things. They're so beautiful and they're natural.
Well, they really add to the feather. That's for sure. They're beautiful.
Yes, and I brought my I brought a whole.
Well,
bunch
Dawn,
of different-
a couple of weeks ago, or maybe a couple of months ago now. Well, no, maybe back in March, was it? You had said to me, oh, look what I made. And he pulled out of his pocket this beautiful little spoon. He said, I just thought I would throw this together and see how it works. So I wanted you to show them your beautiful little spoons, Don.
My mama said I always was a big baby. So I made a baby spoon. I told her mom, she said, I am your baby. I am the youngest.
They're perfect for like jams or jellies or honey, or if you're doing like a little charcuterie board.
Yeah, these are great little gifts. I designed these because my sister asked me for a couple. So I made these little spoons. And one thing you know about honey, and I didn't know, if you put metal, like a metal spoon in it, it actually takes something out of the honey. A guy was telling me this the other day. So that's why they always use wooden spoons, because it doesn't take something out of the honey. And it's something good for us. I do not know exactly what that is, but it's just brought to my attention. These little guys are a lot of fun. A lot of jam spoons, sugar. You can do pretty well anything with them. This, I don't know if I'll put it up as close again. You can see the different, the lines in it. This is actually called curly maple. It's a beautiful wood, and it's very hard. And I'll show you different styles of things and see if you can see it better. This is a rice spoon. This spoon actually has a dip in it. So when you're taking rice out of a cooker, it'll actually pick up quite a bit, and you can use it for picking up pretty well anything. But I think you can see that. There it is. Can you see the pattern on it, Julie?
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Yeah, and it's a very hard wood too. So by using mineral oil, you can change out the colors of your wood. This is what they call a push-pull rod. So if you're baking, you can pull the oven rack out, and then you can use the tip to push it back in. That's walnut. And what the mineral oil does is it just enhances the color, and it darkens it for some reason. I don't know why, but it's absolutely beautiful what it does
now,
to the wood.
Now, Don, how do you, if you put your spoon in preserves and it's sticky and goopy, how do you wash them? Can you just put it under the hot water, or what do you do?
You can just wash it under, just put soap. Wash it under hot water, cold water, and then just basically towel dry it. You want to keep them as dry as possible, and don't soak them in water. Don't put them in anything that has to do with heat, especially a dishwasher, because people do. Okay. They put them in dishwashers and they split them.
And they'll crack the wood. Okay.
Oh, yeah. No, then it's garbage. Okay. If you find over time that they dry out, all you do is you take mineral oil, just put it on it, just rub it on it, and just let it sit overnight, and take a towel and rub it, and it's done. And it just replenishes the oil inside these spoons.
Where do you get food grade mineral oil? Is that something that you can get like at Home Depot or?
Yeah, you can get it at Home Depot. It's you can use that, or you can just use any mineral oil, because I think it's SD something. It's approved. On it.
It's all food grade essentially. It's
pretty well, yeah. Actually, between mineral oil and food grade, there's actually it's just the way they purify it. It's really not much difference. I think they just put a title on it and they sell it that way, because they can sell it for more expensive. But I use food grade because I feel like that's the highest quality that I can give the customer, and I feel safe that way. I feel comfortable, and I think they would too with that.
Yeah.
So there's Go ahead,
no, I was just going to say, I know Margaret is a wood turner, and I wondered if I could open it up for some questions. Maybe Margaret would like to go first, if you have any questions or thoughts for Dawn, Margaret.
I had to figure out how to unmute myself.
You got it.
No, I like working with all the different woods too. I haven't done any wood turning for about 3 years, but it was just fun using the purple heart, the yellow heart, ash, oak, walnut, maple, you know, just a lot of fun working with wood.
Do you have a piece there you could show us, Margaret? Do you have one of your bowls handy or your plates?
Hang on.
Don, we were very fortunate that, like you, Margaret shared with us some of her beautiful work. So Nicole and I have a little plate. We have your feather. We have your worry bird. Like we're very spoiled, aren't we, Nicole?
You are going to have to open a store soon.
I know, we're very spoiled.
Can you see that?
Oh, wow. That's
beautiful. It's beautiful, Margaret.
Yeah.
Oh, it's gorgeous.
Yeah. That's gorgeous. Wow.
That's absolutely gorgeous. Beautiful. Yeah. That's wow.
Yeah.
You guys are spoiled, man. I tell you. I'm going to have to say, I'm going to wear a badge. I work at the center. Spoil me.
I work at Colburn Center. That's right.
Please spoil me.
That's right.
That's absolutely beautiful. You know, I tried lathe work once, but I but the wood was dry. When I hit it, it blew up in my face and scared me. I said, you know what? Never do oak again. It was only 80-year-old dry oak. And I found out later on that oak was the worst thing you could do. So I still have all my tools, but I've never really got into it. But I will later for sure. That is an absolute awesome art form. I love it.
Have you got something else there to show us, Margaret?
Yeah. Can you see these?
Look, yes.
Oh, yeah.
I can see one. Move over. Go the opposite. There you go. Now I can see two. There you go. Right there.
Okay. 1 + 1 = 2.
Did you turn those as well?
Yes, I did.
Those are adorable little snowmen.
Yeah, did you go to a class, Margaret, to turn them, to learn how to do it? Or did you just pick it up naturally?
I belong to the Golden Horseshoe Wood Turners Guild.
Yeah.
And they showed us a lot of stuff.
Yep. Yep. I know those guys up there. Yeah. Yep. I know a few guys that are in there. It's been
a
while.
Do you know Joe Love?
Yes, I do.
He's a carver and a wood turner now.
Yeah. Yeah, he is.
Margaret, have you ever done any carving, or was it just wood turning that you got into?
Just wood turning.
Wood turning. Would carving be of interest to you, because you are very hands-on with your other types of projects?
I like to do stuff that doesn't take me 5 weeks to finish.
Carve a spoon much faster. More satisfying, I'll tell you, quick-wise. Yeah, you know, I had an owl. It took me 7 years to finish.
Oh my goodness.
I did it for a friend. Not a friend no more. No, I just want to get rid of friends. Problems a lot, and they won't come back. Fantastic.
That's amazing.
No, it took me 7 years to do it, but it did turn out fabulous.
I bet. Don, I'm going to turn it over to May. May, do you have any questions for Don?
Let's see. I have two.
It's only if you want to. We just thought I wanted to give everybody a chance to chat.
Oh, I was about doing my chat, but no, just hang on.
I see your comment there. Very interesting. And I love your spoon from May.
Yeah, I was about to send check, you know, because it's really nice. I used to be first experience for me, but my grandson loves wood cutting. So I may send him to Dawn.
Wonderful. Well, I know thank you, Dawn. Daniel put in the chat here, Dawn's website is called forthebirds.ca with the number 4, for the birds. If you wanted to pop in and see some of Don's work, you can look at his website. But some of you may not know this, but Don's a local Oakville business owner. He runs Claude's vacuum store on Kerr Street. So if you have any vacuum needs, you can go see Don there too.
Thank you, Don.
Yeah, I was fortunate to buy the business, and it's actually served such two great loves I've had. One being in the vacuum business for 29 years, and being in carving, I think 36 now, maybe one more year on top of that. And if you want to ever see my carvings, or you know, you can buy the spoons and buy the stuff here. You can view everything here, and you can walk in the store anytime. We're open. Days a week, so the pandemic hasn't shut us down, and we are essential, so you're allowed to.
Wonderful.
Just mask, please.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Well, Don, we are so thankful that you took the time today to come and visit us on Zoom, your first Zoom, and you did great. Yeah. Way to go.
Yeah, it wasn't too shiny. I'm really happy.
No, you're good. You put some matting powder up there.
Yeah, we didn't have to send her.
I hear you can get hair in a can. Great.
Anyway, we're so thankful for you, Don, and we love seeing you every Thursday here at the center, and we appreciate your time today, and you appreciate your time here and all that you give to our students and to our community. So thank you for that, and I wish everybody a marvelous Tuesday.
Yeah. Thank you, Judy. Thank you, Daniel. Thank you, Don.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Bye, everybody.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. Okay, everybody. We'll see you Thursday. Have a wonderful day.